touch us, to change us, to move us into relationship with you. Father, we thank you for this privilege of being together before you. And now, Lord, bless this service. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen. Are you awake this morning? Someone made a comment, I think it was Allison. She said, it sounds awfully quiet in here this morning. The scripture says, arise and shine, for your light has come. Then the glory of the Lord has shined over you. Wake up, sleeper, from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Are you awake this morning? Let's sing together. Arise and shine.
Come on, sing up. Rise up and praise me.
The Lord is calling. This is the day. Let's see the Lord. All right?
Share with anyone else but you. And Lord, I pray that you would
minister to that individual this morning. As they pour their heart out to you, Lord, hear their cries. Hear the anguish of their heart and meet their need, we pray. And Lord, for those that are struggling with relationship issues, those who are struggling with perhaps issues at work, a strain, the stress is becoming overwhelming. Maybe things aren't going right at home. Maybe there's sickness and extenuating circumstances that are just stretching the very, and it's seemingly squeezing the very life right out of us. Lord, I pray that you would come in your sweetness, come in your power, come in your fullness, minister to every heart this morning. I pray that you would remove the distractions from our minds today so we can focus intently on the face of God. I pray, Lord, that we be able to catch a glimpse of your glory today as we gaze into your face. We know, Lord, that we catch a glimpse of you, that the things of this earth, as the psalm says, will grow strangely dim in the light of your glory and grace. Speak through your messenger today. Speak in power. Give him holy boldness to speak the truth in love, but to speak it plainly with no regrets, knowing that with full confidence that what he speaks is not from the flesh, but from you. Then open our minds, open our ears, open our eyes to receive everything that you have in store for us today. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Now as our ushers come to receive the offering today, we want to thank you for your many blessings. Thank you for providing for our every need. Thank you for the faith you've given to us to trust you, that even though you've called us to give sacrificially, that we can never outgive you. And you've promised that we could test you in this and try you and see if you would not open the floodgates of heaven and pour out such a blessing that we couldn't contain it. Lord, you've shown us that as we trust in you and believe in you, that you keep your promise and your word is true. Now bless us all for your prayer, pray in Jesus' holy name.
Thank you.
got a few things before we get into the scripture this morning. I want to share a couple of announcements and a couple of prayer needs and concerns. Downstairs on the welcome table, you will find a new address for Micah Burkhart, who's at Southern Seminary's undergraduate program called Voice College. And his address there, if you want to get in touch with Micah, you can pick that up, and it's a sticky thing. You can stick it in your address book. Also down there on that table are, not the yellow form, that's to tell me what it is, there are these little cards. These are prayer request cards. And there'll be some version of this, hopefully, out there over the next little bit. And my encouragement to you is, take one of these cards and fill it out for us. Drop it in the offering plate, give it to me, give it to Paul. Let us know what the Lord's doing in your life. And some of those requests will need to be shared with the congregation as a whole. We know that, and we'll try to do that. Our promise to you is that if you fill out the card and we receive it back, we will pray for your need. Either as a staff or as a church, and we're not sure exactly how we're going to do this going forward long term, but we want to get a written understanding of what it is on your heart, what's going on in your life. Good examples this week, just this weekend even. It's been kind of a spiritual battle kind of week for several families in our church. Some personal things going on, some personal issues and different things. But also we've had Wally's nephew Wesley pass away. And so we need to be in prayer for his family. Dave Markham, who normally sits in the second service back around where Harold and Brenda are, good friends with Kevin Law. He's been with us at least a year probably, maybe a little bit longer. Dave's had lung cancer and went to the hospital yesterday with a heart arrhythmia, AFib, whichever it was, at Hancock. They moved him to Community North yesterday afternoon. Last night, about 10 o'clock, I got a call from Kevin that he was on his way to the hospital. We talked about 11, and the doctors have told Dave last night he wouldn't make it through the night, that his lungs had filled with blood. There was just nothing else they could do. And I have not got word this morning of his condition. I'm waiting for Kevin or Ken to give me a call and let me know an update. But just some pressing needs among our family members. We need to continue to remember Bud's mom as well, and her care and treatment that she needs with her Alzheimer's. And so a lot of needs going on among us. I want you to know those before we get into the Word this morning, that we should be praying ongoing for one another. As I've been telling you over the last couple of weeks, I've begun to start my morning not just praying for Calvary, which I've done for a long time. Y'all may remember this, may not, I'll remind you. When I wake up on any morning of the week, first thing I do is hit the snooze button. I don't like to get up the first time the alarm goes off. But I use that time between the snoozes to pray. And it's God's reminder of me. It's the way that God works for me to spend some time in prayer. And so this morning I began to pray for our church, for Paul, for myself, for those who would be leading, and for you all, for the Sunday school teachers, and for the things that would happen in our services today. And I've extended that now to other churches around, and that group is growing, not that just the group that I'm praying for, but the groups that are praying for one another are growing. And so we've got now about 10 pastors engaged in this effort to get our churches engaged to pray for not just one another, but for other churches. And so continue that good work. We're hearing good reports, and the Lord is going to do something amazing as we pray together for His glory. Now for the good stuff. Matthew chapter 7. This is part of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' most famous sermon. I know I've preached through this as a whole just within the last couple of years, but want to pull out a particular a section this morning to talk about. As Jesus is the great discipler, he does both follow me and watch me and teaching. And there's probably other ways in which Jesus disciples his disciples. But this morning I want to look at the teaching ministry of Jesus. In particular, I want you to pick up in chapter 7 and verse 13 as he talks a little about the kingdom. One of my favorite things to talk about, the kingdom of God. What does it take to be known as one of His own? Jesus wants there to be no question in our minds or the minds of others where we're going. Yesterday morning, I was in the hospital room with Dave Markham. Ken was there, I was there, the nurses had stepped out, and I looked at Dave and I said, "Dave, you're pretty sick. Do you know where you're going?" And his answer was, "Yes, I've made peace with Jesus. I'm ready to go to heaven." Do you know where you're going? Do you have confidence? I believe God wants us to have that kind of confidence. It wasn't long after that question that the nurse came back in the room and asked Dave, "Do you have any last orders? Have you made a living will? If your heart stops, do you want us to shock you, to resuscitate you? Do you want us to do chest compressions? If you need a ventilator, do you want us to put you on the ventilator?" See, Dave was able to answer those questions because David made a peace in his heart that he knew what was next. Each one of us gets to answer those our own way. I'm not going to tell you how he answered, and I'm not going to tell you how you need to answer. You need to make those decisions for yourself. But I'll tell you this, he had peace and confidence as he answered those questions. Because either way, he knows where he's going. Confidence. As Jesus teaches about the Father in heaven, his desire is that we will build that confidence in our lives so that we will know. Listen to what Jesus teaches the people who are gathered around on the hillside. He says, "Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the road is broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who go through it. The narrow, how narrow is the gate and difficult the road that leads to life, and few find it. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravaging wolves. You recognize them by their fruit. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? In the same way, every good tree produces good fruit, but a bad tree produces bad fruit. A good tree can't produce bad fruit, neither can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that doesn't produce good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So you'll recognize them by your fruit. Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, 'Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name, drive out demons in your name, and do many miracles in your name?' Then I will announce to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you lawbreakers.'" Now, if I have time at the end, I'm going to go a little bit further, because the next teaching is on the two foundations, the one who's built on the rock and the one who's built on the sand. And Jesus is trying to make a serious point to us here that we need to know with certainty where we stand and where we're going. I love this illustration that he uses about the road, because the road itself is not the destination. I was had the privilege of celebrating the national holiday that happened on Friday, August 15th. Y'all know what national holiday that is, don't you? Y'all don't know what national holiday that is? It's opening day of squirrel season. I can't believe Calvary Baptist doesn't know that. I had the privilege of celebrating the opening day of squirrel season. Got into the woods. When you're in the woods, you're not on the road. But my truck was by the road. To get home, I had to get back to the road. Now, my goal at the end of the morning was to get back home. In order to get home, to inherit the good lunch that Allison would have ready for me, not the squirrels that aren't such a good lunch, but nonetheless are eating, I had to get home. To get home, I had to get to the road, but the road wasn't the end of the journey, it was the beginning of the journey to get to where I was going. Now, I had to choose, once I was on the road, the path that I would take, because there are many splits off the road. I like the illustration of the road, because the road's not the end. It's the journey. It's the path that gets us to the end. You got to know where you're going in order to know what road to take. And I'll tell you right now, there may be many paths to Greenfield, but there's only one road to heaven. There's only one road to heaven. Jesus says the way to the Father is through the Son. No one gets there unless they go through Him. There's only one road. Jesus says that there is a narrow road road that lots of people like to get on and hang out together. And we got to make sure we get on the right road. He says, enter through the narrow gate. He talks in another parable about him being the good shepherd. And the good shepherd is the gate. And to get into the pen where you're safe and under the protection of God, you got to come through the gate of the good shepherd. He's there to protect us. He's there to love us and take care of us. But we must enter through the gate. And once we enter through the narrow gate, I want you to picture the gate. When I grew up in southwest Missouri in a small town called Webb City, it was a former golf resort area where we lived. Houses were built on top of this old golf course. We'd find golf balls buried in the grass and along the creek and different places. And this is, I don't even know how long the housing industry had been there. Probably 20 years later, there's still golf balls being found. In fact, one of the streets was golf. The other street was par. We lived on par. In our backyard, there's a big circle. So all of our backyard connected, all the neighbors' backyards connected in this circular addition. And my best friend lived catty corner behind our house. There was a fence from the neighbor on my left as I'm looking. There's a fence in the house directly behind us, and those two yards come together, those two fences. To get to my best friend's house, we cut the fence. We put in a gate. The gate was about yay big. I don't know where they ever found a gate that small, but it's the only gate that would fit between those two fences without us really tearing it up. But in order for he and I to have full access to one another, as young children, best friends growing up together in this small community, we needed a gate. Our parents didn't trust us to climb the fence, because what happens when you climb a good old-fashioned fence back in the day? We only had one or two pairs of britches, depending on the time of year it was. When you start climbing fences, your britches get ripped, and mom was not very happy. So we needed a gate to keep everybody happy. To get through the gate, you had to go single file, one at a time. It was a personal decision to get through the gate. Dad couldn't carry me through the gate. It was too wide. Couldn't walk hand in hand through the gate. All right, it was too narrow. I had to go through the gate by myself. He had to go through the gate by himself. Anyone that wanted to get through the gate had to go on their own. They had to make a decision to enter through the gate. Jesus says to get to the kingdom of heaven, you've got to go through the narrow gate. One at a time, each individual person making a decision for themselves who they will choose to follow. Jesus, the gate, takes you to the narrow road. Or the world, the wide and winding road that will take you most anywhere the flesh would want to take you. Where you can find, quote, the pleasures of life and freedom from the thumb of religion. Proverbs says there's a way that seems right unto man, but in the end leads to death. That wide road may be enticing, may sound good, may look good in the beginning, but in the end, it leads to death. Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the road is broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who go through it. It's popular in today's world, as it has been probably for most of society, to follow the crowd. We see examples all over the world, most recently following the crowd in Ferguson, Missouri, caused riots. Following the crowd. Every rioter didn't start the riot. Most of the rioters followed the crowd. Following the crowd does what? Causes you to turn your brain off and to do things you wouldn't do on your own. Following the crowd causes destruction. Far too often we follow the crowd. We do what everybody else is doing, whether it makes sense to us or not. We do it because it must be right. There's a lot of people doing it. Well, sometimes if a lot of people are doing it, we need to ask ourselves, why? What's the end result? God says this leads to destruction. In verse 14, he picks back up and says, how narrow is the gate and difficult the road that leads to life, and few will find it. I know I hit this quite a bit, but I still think it's necessary. I think churches that say, pray a simple prayer, say the name of Jesus and you'll be saved, and that's all there is to it, have done a disservice to Christianity. Because Jesus tells his disciples to take up your cross and follow me. He says, if you don't hate your mother and your father and your brother and your sister, you got no place in my kingdom. And what he's saying is not so much that we should have hate in our hearts, but he says we should be known by our love. But in comparison to the love that we show for Christ and the desire to serve him and be with him, that other relationships would be so far separated from our love for Christ as our primary focus that it would seem as though we're treating those lesser in a lesser way. We need to follow the narrow road that he says is difficult. If Christianity is too easy, I think we need to ask ourselves, are we following Jesus? Are we following Satan? It's been written that Satan doesn't mind giving you a blessing. In fact, Satan is in the business of giving us blessings, if the blessing he gives us keeps us from seeking God any further. If it limits our walk and relationship with Jesus Christ, he doesn't mind giving you $100 if it means you're not going to go to church anymore. He doesn't mind giving you a better job if it means you're going to work on Sundays and you're going to miss the blessing of being a part of the fellowship of God. He doesn't mind giving you a little blessing to take away a greater blessing that God desires you to have in the end. But Jesus says it's difficult to follow me. So if your Christian walk is too easy, I wonder if you're walking on the right path. If you're not encountering difficulty from day to day and time to time, I wonder if you're on the right path. I ask that about myself regularly. If things are too simple and too easy, am I really doing enough for Jesus? Because he says the road that leads to heaven is narrow. You've got to go through the gate, and it's winding, it's difficult, and it's a tough path. I like the tough paths. I like to hike, and when I go hiking, I like to get off the easy cut path. Yesterday, I decided that, or Friday, I decided I would be on a ridge, and I like to get off the ridge, which means you got to go down into the gully and come back up on the other side, and it's difficult hiking. But it's so much more fun for me to challenge myself and to ask, can I make it down and can I make it back up? It's part of the excitement for me is taking on that challenge. And I think in the Christian life, we need to be excited about the challenge that lies ahead as we look at the two roads and we make a choice. Are we going to walk with Jesus, where only he has trod? Are we going to walk with the world, where there are less obstacles? How narrow is the gate and difficult the road that leads to life, if you find it? As I travel across my backyard to our little gate, I will cross through the gate into the play land, imagination land, into that land where I had fulfillment of friendship, safety and security. The two yards were connected by a gate. Both offered protection as long as we stayed on the path. Jesus is saying it's worth it to follow him. He's not saying follow me so you can be miserable. He's saying follow me and it will be rewarding, but it won't be easy. Most rewarding things in life don't come easy. The best things in life have to be earned, they have to be worked for. I've been married 15 years. Allison's had it easy. But I've had to work hard. I'm easy to love, but I've had to work hard. Marriage is difficult, isn't it? Very few people are blessed with a spouse like I'm blessed with, where I don't know if we've ever had an argument or raised our voice at each other. Now, I've raised my voice, just not at her. I know better. Most marriages I encounter are difficult. They're tough. You know why? Because two sinners have come together to make a life together. And it's difficult and it's painful. But it's worth it when you do it well. It's worth the work. We're going to talk about marriage next week. We're going to talk about Jesus' design for marriage. We're going to spend a lot more time on that particular illustration because I think it's important. Not that everybody get married. The Apostle Paul says it's better that some stay single. In fact, he says it's the better approach to life for those who can handle it. I think the majority of people can't handle it, staying single. Therefore, we need to be married. And Jesus develops this picture of what marriage is, and we'll develop it next week, of Christ in the church, and how God loves us and makes us perfect so that we can be reconciled to the groom, Jesus Christ. That's what we're going to deal with next week. It's nice when you're in a marriage that is reciprocal and you love one another, but it's not easy. It's hard work. But you enter through that narrow gate of matrimony and you take a journey down the narrow road with many difficulties that bring great joy. Childbirth. Great difficulties. Go back to Genesis. It's God's punishment for sin. You will bear children with much pain. But what a joy when the pain subsides. There's a child placed on your chest to love and to nurture and to raise. It's not just in childbirth that we have a blessing and a challenge. Oh, those terrible twos and threes and fours and fives. Teenage years, I haven't got there yet, praise the Lord. But they're coming quick. But what a joy it is to have children. But what a difficulty it is to parent. Jesus says, don't choose the easy road. You know what the easy road is? Kids, do whatever you want to. It's going to be okay. I'll feed you. I'll house you. I'll pay for whatever you need. Just live your life the way you want to. That's the easy road. There's no conflict, right? Where's that road lead in? Down at the county jail. Lives of heartache. It's the narrow road that leads to ultimate joy. It's the narrow road that brings us into right relationship with the Father. He says, beware of false prophets. There are going to be those who are going to tell you the wrong things because they want you to take the wide road. I got a friend from seminary who's preaching in Plainfield tonight. He's in Mississippi now. His home church is First Baptist Church Vicksburg, the church that was up here staying with us a few weeks ago. Justin Peters, he's got cerebral palsy. He went through seminary the same time I did. I took him to play major golf. First time he'd ever played major golf. He's been on crutches or on a wheelchair his entire life. We'd take the golf club to his crutch, and he beat every one of us. Justin was a good friend, very patient man, very studious student. Couldn't type because his fingers didn't work. But he would tell different people what to write, and he would write his papers. Very well studied. Justin, as a young boy, went to healing conference to be healed. He was told over and over again the reason he wasn't healed is he didn't have enough faith. Broke his faith, attempted to break his faith. He tried to follow a false prophet. He said, if you only do these things, you will have great reward in the end. It never worked for Justin. He was wise enough, had enough guidance, had enough foundation to figure out. God's purpose wasn't to heal him. God's purpose was to use him to heal others. Spiritually heal. To bring hope of an eternal life in heaven. Just as preaching about these false prophets this week at Plainfield Baptist Church. He's there this morning, tonight. He'll be there Monday and Tuesday night. I'm hoping to go see him tomorrow night. If I'm able. It's been a while. But the false prophets we got to watch for. They come to you in sheep's clothing. They present themselves nice and glowing words and warm hugs. It says they're inwardly ravaging wolves. What's the job of Satan? It's to steal, to kill, and destroy. But how does he come to us? As a prince of light. As a beautiful angel. As one who brings all those desires of our heart. You know the problem with the desires of our heart? if our heart's desire is not Jesus, it leads us down the wrong road. Our heart's desire has got to be focused through that narrow gate on Jesus, or we'll get what we want. And what our hearts in the flesh want is separation from God. Since they come as ravaging wolves, and you'll recognize them by their fruits. Another great teaching in the New Testament, the fruit. What is the fruit? It's the outward example of what's inside of us. It's what people see of our character and our nature. It's what we do with response to what we've heard or learned or become. We're to recognize the fruit of the wolves. We will see their fruit. We're all producing fruit, aren't we? Some fruit's good to eat. Some fruit isn't. Some fruit's ripe. Some fruit's rotten. Some fruit's not fully developed. Some is just right. How do you know the fruit? Is it good? Is it bad? Take a melon. What do? You got to thump it, right? If you don't thump right, you don't bite. You're testing how good the melon is, the fruit. Because you want the good fruit, right? You don't want the bad fruit. We're to test the fruit of those that we encounter as we go down the road of life. If we start testing the fruit around us and all the fruit is rotten, I got news for you. You're on the wrong road. There's a road that leads to life, and there's a road that leads to death. And if you're on the road with all the bad fruit, there's only two ways that's going to go. One, you're going to go down with them. Or two, you're going to be the light in the darkness that brings them off that road back to the right road. But far too many people get on the road with good intentions and stay on the road and never find the narrow road. I'm not saying we stay away from the world. I'm saying far too often we find ourselves among the wrong type of fruit. Jesus talks about the wheat and the tares. He's going to keep one. He's going to cast one out. When it comes harvest time, which will you be? Among the wheat or among the tares? He talks about the sheep and the goats. The sheep get to stay with the good shepherd, but what happens to the goats? They're cast out into outer darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. You got to make a choice. Which road are you going to be on? Which gate are you going to travel through? The narrow or the wide? We need to be able to recognize spiritually with wisdom the fruit of those that lead to destruction. But we also need to recognize in our own lives that if we're not producing good fruit, that we're going to be trimmed, cut back, thrown out. So we need to make sure we're producing the right kind. He says you should recognize a tree by its fruit. In the same way, every good tree produces good fruit. But a bad tree produces bad fruit. He's saying there's only two types of trees. Not maple and oak and sycamore. Two types. There's only two types. God makes things real simple. God is the best mathematician I know. He keeps it simple. You're either good or you're bad. What's Jesus say in Revelation about the lukewarm church? I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Because there is no lukewarm. You're either good or you're bad. You're hot or you're cold. You're saved or you're lost. You're going to heaven or you're going to hell. There is no in between. You're on the right road or you're on the wrong road. And every road that's not the right road is the wrong road. You know them by your fruits. My favorite preacher is Tony Evans. You all know that. I'm not my own favorite preacher. I don't know if you knew that. I'm not. My favorite preacher is Tony Evans. You know what Tony Evans says? The Christian church, those who know Jesus Christ, need to get fruity. We need to start showing our fruit. We need to be picked by somebody. Back to discipleship. What's Jesus teaching? That we need to have good fruit so somebody will pick us. So we can pour into them. So that they can be more like Jesus. There's only two types of trees. Good and bad. There's only two types of fruit. Good and bad. God makes it pretty simple. There are only two paths in this life. The path to heaven reconciliation with the Father through the Son, and the path to hell. And the path to hell has every other path on it. The same way, every good tree produces good fruit, but every bad tree produces bad fruit. Verse 18, a good tree can't produce bad fruit. God, when He changes our hearts and lives, we can't produce bad fruit. Because we're His. Problem is, a lot of people who think they're going to heaven aren't. Because they never met the gardener. They never met the one who plants the seed. They never met the one who brings the sunshine and the rain. They never met the one who causes them to grow. A few years ago, a group in the daycare that came through, a group of girls, they all thought they were horses. They loved to neigh. They loved to gallop. They loved to play horse. Some of them even had long manes hanging down over the back of their neck. They thought they were horses. And they ran around like horses, and they talked like horses, and they played like horses, and they loved horses. But not a one of them was a horse. They were all little girls. And they were created to be little girls, not horses. And no matter how hard they try, they can never become a horse. And some of them tried. Because God didn't create them to be horses, He created them to be little girls. Those little girls have grown up. Now they're young ladies. They're no longer trying to be horses because they found out there's something better. God created new young ladies who will become young women. Who will become women. God wanted to be a horse. He would have made them a horse. He didn't make them a horse. He made them people. They had to learn that your goal is not to become a horse, but to become the best person they can be. When we become a Christian, our goal is to become the best Christian we can be so we can produce good fruit, so we be recognized as God's chosen people. For we send His Holy Spirit to convict us and to challenge us to come to Him, to show us the narrow gate so we can cross into that narrow road that will take us to heaven. And along the road, we need to be producing fruit that's recognized as good. Because any fruit that's not recognized as good, by definition, then is bad. And it means we're on the wrong road with the wrong people doing the wrong things. If we want to honor God, we've got to get on the right road, producing the right fruit. Because if we're not, every tree that doesn't produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. That's hell. Cast out into outer darkness. It says, so you will recognize them by their fruit. It didn't say we will judge them according to their fruit. We will recognize them by their fruit. When we recognize their fruit, we've got to make a choice. Are we going to go hang out with the rotten? Or are we going to be a part of the good? Because it's by our fruit that we'll be known. We are to recognize the fruit. Recognizing fruit is not the same as judging. It's not the same as judging. But if we're not wise enough to recognize the fruit, we may end up in the wrong pile. We've got to make a choice this morning where we will be. Because in verse 21, he says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But only the one who does my will, the will of my Father. And on that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we drive out demons in your name? And do many miracles in your name? He said, I will announce to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you lawbreaker. There will come a day and time when we'll stand before Almighty God. We will be in the defendant's seat. And the Lord of Lords will be the judge. And He will look down at us. And we will have to account for our life. There's only one question that's going to be asked. Because there's only one question that matters. The question is simply this. Whose are you? remember Bud telling a story about being in a gas station traveling one day and ran into a guy that worked with his father and immediately recognized Bud because he knew Bud's father. Whose are you? There was no denying who Bud was. He was his father's son. There's no denying in my family who I am. I look and act like my father. I can't pretend to be somebody I'm not. It's clear. When we get to heaven, we stand before judgment. There's only one question that matters. Whose are you? Which gate did you enter? The narrow or the wide? The easy or the difficult? Good fruit or bad fruit? The house built on solid foundation or one built on sand that gets washed away? Whose are you? For those of us who walk with Jesus, we don't even have to answer the question. You see, because we have an advocate, a counselor, who stands for us in that judgment seat. And Jesus says, Father, you gave him to me. He's mine. Whose are you? Jesus says, Father, you gave him to me, and none that you've given to me will be lost, but they will all be kept until I glorify them. That he is mine, and I am proud to call him mine, and I will keep him as you promised I could. See, if we're with Jesus on the narrow road through the narrow gate, when the Father asks, whose are you? Jesus answers, he is mine. But if you're not his, you stand condemned by the choices you've made and the fruit that you've produced. The question this morning is very simple. Whose are you? And if you're his, what kind of fruit are you producing? Jesus is telling his disciples, make sure you're on the right road. Make sure you're traveling with me. Make sure you enter through the narrow gate. Make sure the fruit that you're producing is in line with the character that I've given you. And in the end, Jesus will claim you. Whose are you? If you don't know Jesus Christ this morning, will you make him Lord of your life? I'm not going to try to give you an easy sell into Christianity. God has promised that the narrow road will be difficult, but the end result is worth it. God has promised that along the way, in the middle of the difficulties, he will reveal himself to you through his Holy Spirit who will dwell in you, and you will find comfort and peace in the midst of the struggles, and he will receive glory for it, and you will receive his gift of peace. But will you choose the right road? See, it's not just knowing who he is. Some will call and say, Lord, Lord, and he'll say, I don't know you. The question is today, will you follow him and make him Lord of your life, master of your life? Will you get to know him in a personal way, in a personal relationship? Are you willing to dedicate the rest of your life to knowing Jesus so that you can know his Father in heaven? See, if you're willing to do that, let me offer you what God offers you this morning. It's not my gift to give. Jesus already gave it. But let me just make you aware of it. See, if you will chase after Jesus with the rest of your life, and you will commit to that this morning, God says that you have entered through the narrow gate, and that you will become his child. And Jesus will say, he is mine, and he will never let you go. Your fruit will go from bad to good and never be changed. Are you willing to walk with Jesus? If you already know Jesus this morning, will you be willing to say, will you just be willing to inspect your fruit? Say, God, help me to inspect my fruit. I want to produce good fruit because you have made me in your image. In the image of your Son through the rebirth of salvation, Lord, help me to produce good fruit. Maybe some of us have some rotten fruit hanging on our branches because we haven't exercised our Christian rights and walked on the right road and had the right stuff poured into us. And maybe you just need to come to the altars and say, Lord, forgive me. Pluck that bad fruit so good fruit can replace it. Trim me back so that I can grow the way you would have me to grow and not the way of the world. See, the Lord is calling us for a harvest. Are you willing to be a part of that? Like walking on his road? That's the question. will pray for. And as I pray, you ask God, Lord, am I where I need to be? Am I on the right road? Am I producing the right kind of fruit? And then you only have one of two responses. Either, Lord, I need you to be Lord of my life, to be my Savior, to give me new life and new birth. Or you need to say, Lord, help me be better at who you called me to be so I can be more like you. Father God, speak to our hearts. Challenge us this morning that we would be more like you, less like the world, that you would be glorified in our lives. Help us to choose to be good fruit, producing and reproducing the image of Christ in our lives. Lord, I thank you for the teaching of Jesus that calls us to be about this. And this morning, Lord, if any need to be saved, to be changed, to make that commitment of a lifelong journey through the narrow gate or the narrow road, give them the courage to do it, to step out and say, I want the challenge. I want to be like Jesus. I want the peace and the comfort today and the promise of heaven tomorrow. Lord, won't you come and speak to us this morning? Won't you come into our hearts and challenge us this morning? Give us the courage to respond, because we all need to hear from you. And we all need to be more like you. Speak to us now. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you stand with me? We're going to sing. You respond. We'll be here to receive.
To make a wretch his
announcements for you before we dismiss for Sunday school this morning. One that's not in your bulletin is we're going to be beginning a Discovering Calvary class. It's a get to know us better, know our doctrines, our policy, polity, how we're organized, those kind of things. So even if you've been a member for a while, if you want to learn more about Calvary Baptist Church and about the Southern Baptist Convention, let me invite you. We're going to start that the first Sunday in September. Yes, I know that's Labor Day weekend and that kind of stuff, but that's where we're going to start it, just the same. So we'll meet during the Sunday school hour, starting the first Sunday in September. We'll go 6 to 8 weeks, depending on how long it takes us to get through the stuff we need to get through. And so where we'll meet, we'll tell you which room we'll be in coming weeks. But mark that. You're all invited to be a part of that. And then after a few weeks, we'll get you back into your regular Sunday school classes.
Also, greeters. We still need greeters for the preschool kids, for people as they come into church, and also Patrick needs some sound tech help. So he can show you how. He said it's kind of a learn on the job type thing. You don't have to have any skills other than maybe playing the radio or something. Also, the life choices that announcement's changed a little bit there. The Crisis Pregnancy Center things were put together. There's a basket down the lobby where you can pick up what needs, and as a family, you can have a project where you put together baskets or even a Mr. Fix-It bucket. So I imagine that's for the fellas. But that would be a fun family activity you can do together as a fundraiser. And then don't forget the motorcycle ride. If you enjoy riding motorcycles, there at the end of the month on August 30th, see Greg Shook. If you have any questions about that, he said he's planning on riding again after his accident he had recently. So that supports the Nehemiah House. And then looks like Paul, you want to do an announcement about the thing that's going on next Sunday night?
Sure, next Sunday. Kickoff for the children's musical drama. It'll be Christmas time. I think a week from this Wednesday is the kickoff for the RHEAs.
Yes.
Which is Wednesday night. So we've got bunches of activities to involve our kids coming up, starting up here real soon.
I just checked my text messages. Dave Markin did not pass last night. His breathing is more shallow. He's still on pain-reducing medication to get him through. His daughter left last night from Florida to get up here to be with the family. And so he's still alive at the moment. So remember Dave and his family. He knows the Lord, and he's going to meet him real soon. But keep them in your prayers as they go through this time. The last thing for me is men's retreat. It's not too late to sign up, but you did miss the early registration deadline, so it cost you an extra $10. But get online, sign up for that. Let me know you're planning on going so that we can coordinate rides and all that's going to happen. I'm planning on going Thursday afternoon sometime or early evening. The rest of the crew will be coming down Friday after work to be there for the Friday-Saturday conference. So let me know what you're in for, and that way we can plan for you.
Okay. Let's go ahead. Anybody have any other announcements from the audience? Let's go ahead and stand, and we'll close with prayer and the Sunday school. Lord, we thank you for this day and your many blessings that you provided, Lord. Be with us now in our Sunday school hour as we open the Word and fellowship together. Be with our services yet to follow today. Have your hand upon Pastor Roger and Pastor Paul as they lead us. Be with our midweek services. Lord, put your hand upon Dave Markham now at this time as he's gravely ill. Make his passing into glory easy. Lord, or if it be your will to make him whole again. In your name.